Hi, welcome to Bird Podcast. I'm Shobha Narayan.
Simply beautiful, it's got a fantastic presence, very good looking, and it's like a punctuation mark in that desert landscape. It's a wonderful bird.
That's Arijit Banerjee, a birder and officer in the Rajasthan government. Arijit first encountered the great Indian bustard as a young officer in 1992. Of India's four bustard species, the great Indian bustard evokes the most awe amongst Indian naturalists and the most complexities amongst the people who are tasked to save it.
Apart from an emotional attachment, people have not gained anything saving the bustard.
And that's Anoop K.R., Deputy Conservator of Forests, Desert National Park, Rajasthan. Anoop is a no-nonsense man from Kerala. He has been in the front lines of bustard conservation efforts for decades. He knows and understands both sides of this sensitive issue. But first, some history. The great Indian bustard is the state bird of Rajasthan. The late great Salim Ali, India's best-known ornithologist, wanted the great Indian bustard, or GIB as it's called, to become India's national bird. In his newsletters, Ali pointed out that the purpose of a national bird was to bring public interest, to pinpoint public interest on a bird species that needed protection. It doesn't have to be an ornamental, mythological, or sentimental bird, he said. Therefore, the choice of the peacock was not only meaningless, but misconceived, according to Ali. After all, the peacock didn't and doesn't need protection. Ali goes on to make an argument for the great Indian bustard, and I quote, "The bustard is a large and spectacular bird, indigenous to India, and its numbers, in spite of the legislative ban, are dwindling at an alarming rate," end quote. He wrote this in the 50s. Ali lost his battle to make the great Indian bustard the national bird of India, mostly because of its name. Think about it. If you are a young nation that has made a tryst with destiny, if you are India that has woken up to freedom in 1947, would you want a bird whose name could be misinterpreted? Great Indian bustard. What does that sound like? So Ali lost the battle and the peacock was chosen. He was right in his prediction, though. The bustard did and does need protection. In 1969, there were an estimated 1,260 bustards in India, spread through four states, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, and Madhya Pradesh. Today, Anoop tells me that there are just 140 birds, mostly in Rajasthan. Ornithologists like Bikram Grewal and Azad Rehmani, who have spent a lifetime studying this bird, lament that we are 30 years too late to save this majestic bird. They feel that this would be the first Indian bird species that would become extinct in our lifetimes. The Asiatic cheetah became extinct in India, but that was in the early 20th century. This is the story of the great Indian bustard. Will India save this bird? Let's find out.
The thing I found absolutely fascinating, that a massive bird which needs to run and then take off. So that was a sight which will be etched in my memory forever.
Like Arijit said, the bustard has to do these aircraft takeoff procedures because it is amongst the heaviest flying birds in the world. The Kauri bustard of Africa is heavier. It weighs about 18 to 19 kilograms. The great Indian bustard weighs in at 14 to 15 kilograms. It stands about 1.2 meters tall. That's about 3.3 feet, about the size of a small kid. The females are smaller. During the breeding season, the male bustard develops a white gular sac that falls almost to the ground. Imagine a bag or a backpack around your neck that extends forward till the ground. That's what it looks like. The gular skin is an area of featherless skin that develops around the neck of birds. Frigate birds and cormorants get this, as do a number of amphibians, the lizards and frogs, You might have seen them sort of exploding out of the neck area. In the male bustard, this gular pouch or gular sac is used to make a hooting call that can be heard for up to 2 kilometers, and the purpose is to attract a female. Some basics. This bird, Ardiotis nigriceps, belongs to the family Otididae, which is basically all bustards and floricans. There are 24 bustard species in the world. India has 4. The Great Indian Bustard, Bengal Florican, and Lesser Florican. The 4th, the Hubara Bustard, is a winter visitor.
What I feel, for a wildlife or for a wildlife lover, sighting a Great Indian Bustard in natural habitat is similar to sighting a tiger in its habitat in forest. Okay, you feel the same excitement when you see a bustard moving in a grassland.
That's Gobind Sagar Bharadwaj, conservator of forests in the Jaisalmer area of Rajasthan. Sighting a Great Indian Bustard in its natural habitat is a thrill, like he says. It also requires a long journey, a pilgrimage, if you will. You have to fly to Jaipur or Jodhpur, and from Jodhpur, you drive 5 hours on an excellent highway to Jaisalmer. En route, you will see Pokhran, which was the test site where India detonated its underground nuclear weapon in the early 70s.
It's locally called Godavan.
Call it Godavan or Great Indian Bustard. This bird offers a pulse of the fragile grassland ecosystem of western Rajasthan, just as the tiger offers a pulse of the forest ecosystem.
As of today, in western part of Rajasthan, that is in Jaisalmer district.
Desert National Park is in Jaisalmer district. It is huge, 3,162 square kilometers. It houses the bustard, of course, but is also home to several resident and migratory birds. Eagles, harriers, falcons, buzzards, kestrels, and vultures. You can see short-toed eagles, tawny eagles, spotted eagles, lagar falcons, and kestrels. Of course, you can see the sand grouse and the Great Indian Bustard. The Desert National Park is a stunning, if fragile, ecosystems. There are sand dunes, of course, which occupy about 20% of the area. It also has a collection of fossils of animals and plants that go back 180 million years. There are fossils of dinosaurs that are about 6 million years old. DNP, or Desert National Park, is also arguably the last refuge of the Great Indian Bustard. This bird, which once roamed all over western India and Pakistan, now numbers only 140, give or take, and most of it is in Rajasthan. Will we save it? Is it worth saving? Let's find out.
Bustard is a huge bird. It is not evolved to survive in the present environment.
There are many reasons why Anoop says that the bustard has not evolved to survive in the present environment. Naturalists have called it an awkward species. Heavy, wide-ranging, it's omnivorous. The bustard eats everything. Beetles, bugs, grass seeds, berries, rodents, reptiles, lizards. They feed on crops such as millets, legumes, and groundnuts. On the other hand, the GIB is a slow breeder. The female lays just one egg a year, and this egg is in danger of predation from feral dogs, mongooses, and other monitor lizards and other predators on a pretty much a daily basis. Cattle, which are wide-ranging in the grasslands of Rajasthan, can stamp on the egg. And if the incubating female sees humans, she abandons the egg. So the odds of a chick surviving are slim at best.
A bird which is evolved to cope up with the present day threats would have evolved strategies like both the parents incubate the egg, there can be more than one egg per clutch. But these strategies are not evolved in the case of Great Indian Bustard. Mm. So we have to give extra efforts to make it survive in the present environment.
Now, here's a thought, and I realize that it's controversial, but let me step into it anyway. Like Anoop says, if the bustards had evolved to cope with its present conditions, it would have laid more eggs and had both the male and female participate in the breeding process. To use the Darwinian survival of the fittest theory, does this mean that the bustard is not fit to survive? Birds, after all, are great evolutionary survivors. They have been around for 100 million years. As Jennifer Ackerman says in her fascinating book, The Genius of Birds, these are some of nature's great success stories. They've invented new strategies for survival that in some respect seem to far outpace our own. Somewhere in the mists of time was the first bird, the common ancestor to all birds. Today, there are some 10,400 different bird species, more than double the number of mammal species. In the late 1990s, scientists set about estimating the total number of wild birds on this planet. They came up with a staggering 200 to 400 billion individual birds. That's roughly about 30 to 60 wild living birds per person, per human. So then how do you say that humans are more successful or advanced? It depends on how you define those terms. If it's about survival, then there are more birds surviving on this planet than humans. In Ackerman's book, she introduces us to a professor of biology by the name Louis Lefebvre, L-E-F-E-B-V-R-E. He's a professor at McGill University, Canada, and his specialty is to analyze and assess the intelligence of birds. Scientists prefer to use the name cognition to intelligence. And the classic example of a bird species that is, that sort of exhibited this was in England, when the two species of tits, grey tits and blue tits, they learned how to open the cardboard caps of milk bottles that were delivered on people's doorsteps. Now, birds cannot eat carbohydrates in milk. They only eat the fatty lipids. So the tits first learned this behavior in 1921 in one village. And within 25 years, all the tits in all of England, Wales and Ireland had learned this technique. This is, as Ackerman says, an impressive show of social learning. So what are you measuring when you measure avian cognition? So it's essentially making sense of the world as it changes, figuring out how to solve current day problems, using tools to a certain extent to help you. So it's this adjustability to environmental and social changes and challenges, to be flexible. So some species of birds possess this. The famous example, the supposedly most intelligent bird species is the New Caledonian crow. So when Lefebvre decided to analyze the intelligence of birds, he basically plowed through 75 years worth of journals in which words such as intelligence and tools and novelty and flexibility was used, and came up with a list of bird species that were more intelligent than others. Any guesses? The smartest birds, according to Lefebvre's scale, were corvids, no surprise there, ravens, crows, then came parrots, and then grackles, then raptors like falcons and hawks, woodpeckers, hornbills, gulls, kingfishers, roadrunners, and herons. So he didn't use owls because they're nocturnal and it was hard to study. As far as the lower end of the totem pole in terms of bird cognition and intelligence, there were quails, ostriches, turkeys, nightjars, and bustards. So there's this great story about an Australian when Lefebvre was asked, what is the dumbest bird in the planet? And he said, the emu. And then the next day, the headlines read, Canadian researcher names National Bird of Australia the world's most stupid bird. Bustards, as Anoop has said, need a lot of help to adapt to the new and fast-changing environment. They have not adapted as quickly as city-dwelling birds like feral pigeons and corvids have to human habitation. What is one to do? I mean, do we simply abandon the species because it doesn't have the sense to adapt? It doesn't have the sense to evolve and survive?
It every species deserves a fair chance to survive. That's the bottom line.
There are many elements working against the survival of the great Indian bustard. There are windmills, power transmission lines, all of which are supposed to develop the area. The Indira Gandhi irrigation canal has brought water into this desert, as a result of which farmers now want to encroach on the land to grow guar gum as a livelihood. So forest officials have to take more and more precautions. They create enclosures during the breeding season of the bustards and call them maternity wards of these birds.
We call these closures as maternity wards, and nobody is allowed to enter. That's why how we are protecting its conservation, its breeding sites.
People on the front lines of saving the great Indian bustard see both sides of the equation. On the one hand, the Rajasthani folk who live in Desert National Park in close proximity to these birds don't want them to go extinct. They don't want these critically endangered species to go extinct. On the other hand, what have they gained from this bird?
If bustard can promote tourism and provide better livelihood options for the people, the people will never allow the species to go extinct.
So the tourism can help, is what you're saying?
Yes, only tourism can help, nothing else.
So if you are a tourist in the US, UK, France, Europe, China, Australia, South Africa, and want to see the final swan song or the last dance of this great Indian bustard, come to India, come to Rajasthan, come to Jaisalmer and the Desert National Park, and see the state bird of Rajasthan be a punctuation in the desert. Bird Podcast is produced by Ullas Anand and EcoEdu. If you would like to volunteer with us, we need you to help us research, script, and produce episodes. Please visit birdpodcast.com for details. For now, this is me, Shobha Narayan, signing off. Thanks for listening.